Welcome to Sound and Vision, conversations with contemporary artists and musicians about the creative process. Here's the host of Sound and Vision, Brian Alfred.
Sound and Vision is supported by the New York Studio School. The New York Studio School welcomes artists to join an upcoming 5-day virtual painting marathon with their dean and founder of the legendary Studio School Marathons, artist Graham Nixon. Taking place this November from Thursday, November 10th through Monday, November 14th, the Studio School's legendary marathons present a wide range of art-making strategies, comprehensive critiques, and inspirational discussions. The virtual format enables you to join in real time from your own studio anywhere in the world. Expansive and experimental, marathons equip artists to relate to drawing, painting, and sculpture as methodologies for understanding one's experience in the world, the profound impact of which continues far beyond each marathon's conclusion. Visit nyss.org to apply today. Sound Vision is also sponsored by Golden Artist Colors. Golden makes the world's best acrylic paints and mediums, core watercolors, and Williamsburg oil paints. You can get their supplies in art stores everywhere or at goldenpaints.com. You know what keeps me going? Making work in the studio, podcasting with artists, teaching, being a dad, and everything else going on? Coffee. Specifically, the amazing coffee from Fulcrum Coffee Roasters. Fulcrum makes incredible coffee based out of Seattle, and the cool thing is, you can have it delivered straight to your door. Use the code ALFREDSTUDIO at checkout and get 20% off your order. They even have subscription services where they deliver different origin beans each week, every 2 weeks, every month, however often you want your coffee to arrive. I have it and it's amazing. I love the new blends each time I get a delivery and they're always really good. Check them out at fulcrumcoffee.com. I've been overwhelmed with the support for Why I Make Art, the Sound of Vision podcast book out on Atelier Editions. The messages from people who are into the book is really great. If you have a copy, please leave a rating and review on Amazon or wherever you ordered it from. It goes a long way at getting the book on the radar of other fans of art who might appreciate the stories of all the amazing artists involved. And if you don't have it, consider picking it up. You can get it via the Sound and Vision website page about the book. I hope it gives you some inspiration in your studio. Thomas Jackson was born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and grew up in Providence, Rhode Island. After earning a BA in history from the College of Wooster, he spent his early career in New York City working first in book publishing, then as an editor and writer at Forbes Life magazine. An interest in photography books eventually led him to pick up a camera shooting Garry Winogrand-inspired street scenes, then landscapes, and finally the installation work that he does today. A self-taught artist, Jackson has created a unique process that merges landscape photography, sculpture, and kinetic art. His work has been shown widely, including at the Photography Show in New York, the Center for Contemporary Arts in Santa Fe, the Bolinas Museum in Bolinas, California, and it was named one of the Critical Mass Top 50 in 2012. He won the Installation Still Life category of PDN's The Curator Award in 2013, and he earned second place in Center's Curator's Choice Award in 2014. Thomas and I talk about analog materials, the process of writing, studying turtles, experimenting in the Catskills, making photos, and much more. Here's our conversation.
Where were you born, though?
I was born in Philadelphia.
But raised in Providence? Or wait.
In Rhode Island, yeah.
Rhode Island, okay.
With some stints in Europe, because my dad was a professor. So he got a sabbatical every 7 years. So in...
Nice.
We lived in Germany when I was 10 for 6 months, and then in France for a year when I was 17.
That's cool. So you saw some stuff.
I did. But otherwise, it was Providence, which I hated at the time. But now I kind of like it. It's a cool town.
It's a cool town.
It really is. Yeah. Well, you think that because you didn't grow up there. But
I know what that's about. Yeah. It's what was it like growing up there? I guess if you're outside of that, because most of the people I talk to related to Providence, you know, were going to school there and it was a certain vibe.
Yeah, well, the Providence of my childhood was not nearly as nice as the Providence now. The way that downtown Providence is this beautiful sort of, you know, well-planned landscape with canals and parks and stuff. Downtown Providence was, its claim to fame when I was a kid was that it was the widest bridge in America, because they basically paved over like two rivers completely. Like you couldn't even see the rivers, or is it one river or two river? And like when I was in high school, they basically broke it all open and did what they've done today. But I think, you know, there's just so many parts of Providence that were sort of not places you'd necessarily want to go when I was a kid, but that are now these thriving neighborhoods. And the east side where I grew up has just like gotten much nicer. And the, you know, the thing I love about Providence now that I didn't appreciate when I was a kid is that it's kind of like Brooklyn in a way, in the sense that the east side of Providence, at least, that you can just walk a long distance in any direction without really having to stop. You know, I mean, you know, obviously in Brooklyn you hit some big avenues here and there, but for the most part it's just like oceans of brownstones. Providence is kind of like that too. It's just like, you know, neighborhood after neighborhood. Whereas now we're outside of Philadelphia and you can't go like a half a mile without hitting a huge road that you have to like
an overpass and stuff like that.
Or just like a two to four lane road where people are going 45 miles an hour. And Providence doesn't have that, you know. As a kid, like riding a bike, it's a kind of a paradise.
Philly's where it's laid out. I've never, you know, I grew up in Pittsburgh, so we would go to Philly once in a blue moon. I feel like I never got the lay of the land there. I mean, I went to South Street. Like, there were areas I would go to, and that was pretty much it. I didn't really explore a ton. Museum, coffee shops, that was about it.
Yeah, well, it's weird for me to be back to be in Philly because, as I mentioned, I actually was born here.
Full circle.
And lived here till I was two. And my parents were in Philadelphia, but then they moved to this town called Marion Station, like more or less the year I was born, I think. And I now live like about a mile away from where my parents lived when I was a baby.
You really did draw a map that came back to that starting point.
It's really weird. It's like, did I come back here to die or something? It's very strange.
No, you came back for your rebirth.
That's right.
You like it?
I mean, I like it because it's very close to New York.
Yeah,
it's an hour and a half. I mean, that's kind of where I would like to be, honestly, but.
Right.
It would also be really hard, even if everything was laid out, to just go back to New York and find a place to live and figure out what our kids are going to do and all that stuff.
And that's the wild card. The kids, like the school and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Not that it's impossible or whatever, but it is a little, you know, cumbersome.
It's so complicated. And it's hard for them, too. And our kids, we put them through so much already, you know, going to California and everything.
Right.
But you know, it's livable here, and people are extremely nice. I mean, it's like the eastern extreme of the Midwest, basically. You know,
right?
And you know, it's nice houses and architecture, and you know, but it's also like it doesn't have the vibrancy of that I feel in New York, and I feel kind of bad for Philadelphia sometimes. I feel like it kind of stopped, you know, in the 60s, and it's just sort of like maintaining itself, you know.
Yeah.
Just like putting
control.
Yeah, kind of. But I think there's a lot of cool stuff going on in Philadelphia that I'm sort of bit by bit learning about. I mean, there's a great music scene here, and you know, it's definitely a place where, you know, chefs can experiment before they go to New York, you know.
I mean, rents, they can play.
Cheaper rents. You know, I mean, it's like, for instance, you know, that hot new restaurant in Brooklyn, Laser Wolf, like that basically came from Philadelphia, if I'm.
Oh, really?
I mean, that guy had a restaurant here that he sort of like grew his thing, his brand, and then he'd go to New York. So Philadelphia is kind of like a proving ground for a lot of artists and musicians and stuff, and I think that's really cool.
Yeah, being from a provincial town, there's a real kind of like culture to that town, but there's something really nice about it. And they are like, once you go to New York or San Francisco or LA or something, you realize they are a little slow. Like, it's not quite the pace. And there's something nice about that. And then there's also the fear of not boredom, but being, you know, like missing the fast lane or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is usually, I would think, for the most part, smoke and mirrors. Like, it's, you know, it's more a mindset than anything else, because you're not, if you live in the city, unless you're one of those people who goes out all the time, you're kind of not really engaged in that all the time. But you can dip, it's the idea that you could dip into it. Provincial towns have great food, great culture. There's art and stuff. You know, there's that stuff is there. It's just maybe not running on the treadmill quite as fast as some of the big cities. But then again, affordable comparatively, you know?
Yeah. Well, I think you can definitely find your people anywhere. But at the same time, a place like New York just has like a critical mass of people who didn't fit in those other places or didn't want to be in those other places. It's sort of the island of lost toys or something, you know? I mean, it's like it's more of a concentration of quirky creative people. You just have to look a little harder to find them.
Yeah. And then everyone else, all of them find you in a way when you're here.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You don't have to be too aggressive about it. People just find you.
Yeah.
So, growing up in Providence, your dad was a teacher, right? I mean, was he a creative household?
He's very creative. My dad is a comparative physiologist. He was a professor at Brown, and his life's work was more or less studying turtles. And he was the turtle guy. I think his particular interest was how turtles survive in harsh environments, like a red-eared slider hibernating at the bottom of a freezing cold pond over winter time.
Yeah.
And not breathing the whole time. And so he studied like sort of how they did that and how they survived, how they dealt with the the toxins that would build up in their bloodstream when they weren't breathing and stuff. I think I sort of absorbed his interest in adaptation.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that I think about a lot, because I think my work is a lot about adapting to environments and trying to work within them. To survive.
That's interesting. So your work, in a sense, is born out of turtles.
Could be in a sense. My mother is an artist, and she actually, when I was a baby, we were living, in the Philadelphia area. She was a teacher at Moore.
And
she taught somewhere else before that in North Carolina that I can't remember right now. But she's an artist, and she's sort of a sculptor and a painter and stuff. And you know, I wouldn't say that my work resembles her very closely, but there's definitely some visual motifs that went from her. I think an interest in sort of nature and sort of the forms that nature can take. I think I sort of borrowed from her work somewhat.
Nice.
Perhaps without realizing it.
That's cool. I thought you might say that she was a watercolorist of turtles.
Which would have been
the perfect alignment.
I think some turtles showed up in her work here and there, but
how couldn't they?
It was mostly naked people when I was a kid, which was excruciatingly embarrassing for me.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, was she always representational in her work?
Not always, but a lot of it was and is.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to ask a question that might be a gaffe, and then I'll leave this to the side.
Okay.
The study of the turtles, does that encompass tortoises, or is that nomenclature differential, or is it part of the same?
Well, all tortoises are turtles, but not all turtles are tortoises. So tortoises are like a subset of turtles. But But Don Jackson, my dad, was not. I don't think he did anything with tortoises, as far as I know.
Okay.
Probably because
but tortoises are generally bigger, right? Like they're.
Yeah, like those Galapagos ones are. Yeah, those are tortoises.
That's what
right?
I think of.
Yeah.
Yeah. That, well, I think of like ginormous. Those ginormous ones are amazing.
But then, like sea turtles are pretty huge. You know.
That's true. Yeah. Some of them snap. Yeah, no, they're really fascinating creatures.
That's really cool
what he studied. It was his life's work, basically, right?
Pretty much. I mean, I think he, like, when he was in getting his PhD, I mean, I think he, you know, briefly worked with rabbits and rats or something, but I think he landed on the turtle and just stuck with it.
Yeah.
And got numerous, like, National Science Foundation grants over the years to study turtles.
That's cool. Yeah. That's really. Do you feel like you've inherited a little bit of that kind of like getting very like research and getting interested in one specific thing or project in a way?
I think so, and I think, you know, there was a spirit of exploration in my dad's work that I find really inspiring. I mean, he was, you know, an intellectual and an accomplished person in a way that I can never imagine being, but I think he, at the core of it, he had this just a raw curiosity. And that's where it all came from. And he would you know, have an idea about, you know, turtle respiration, whatever, and design an experiment. And the point of it was the process and the exploration. You know, he didn't have an expectation of what the answer was going to be. It was it was about finding out. That was the important thing.
That's cool. Did you have siblings?
I have one sibling who's older than me.
Yeah. Okay.
He lives in Boston.
Yeah.
Allington.
Nice. And what was the music situation? Actually, having an older brother usually tips you off to good music, or it can. Tip you off to good music early.
Was that, I mean, thing? I wouldn't say that I was ever I mean, I was really into music, but I was never into contemporary music. Mm-hmm. I think there was a brief period when I was probably 12 or something, when I, you know, we had a record player and I would buy like 45s of, you know, whatever the hit single was, or you know, we used to all tape stuff off the radio.
Right.
And make our own mixtapes. But, you know, by the time I was in high school, I was listening to music from the 60s and 70s.
In the rock genre? Or like?
Yeah, jazz? I mean, like, I was so into, like, old Genesis, like Peter Gabriel Genesis.
Nice. Yeah.
In middle school, early high school. Jazz came later.
Yeah.
I mean, I often joke that I just like totally missed the 90s in terms of
which
music.
Which is a big decade. Which is a big one.
And I really like 90s music now. I mean, and I'm like working to go deeper and discover more and more. But I mean, I was like in Seattle in the early 90s for summer. I probably could have like gone and seen Nirvana in like a little club or something. But
yeah,
they were not remotely on my radar because I was listening to like John McLaughlin, Birds of Fire, you know.
Right. A little different.
So, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but you were right at the source.
Totally.
I mean, Seattle in the early 90s, that's where it was.
Yeah.
The 90s, I mean, between grunge and hip-hop in the 90s was incredible, too. So it was a real, it was a good decade.
Yeah, I heard that. Stuff. I heard that.
Someone told you about that?
Yeah, yeah. But music was always a big thing for me, and I was actually, being a musician was one of my first quixotic aspirations.
Oh, nice.
I literally picked up a guitar when I was like 17, but became obsessed with it, and was in a band in college that was really fun.
What got you into guitar? Was it Pete Townsend?
Not Pete Townsend. God, I don't even know what got me into guitar. Maybe it was like the weird jazz I was listening to. But I just started playing it like crazy. But my profile as a musician was was a lot like my profile as an artist, which is that I can do my own thing, but I'm not versatile. I'm not a jack of all trades. Like, if somebody wanted to sit down and jam with me and, like, you know, play Stairway to Heaven or something, like, I can't do that.
Right. They'd have to jam to you.
Yes, but I wrote some songs that I was, you know, kind of proud of, and my buddies wrote some songs, and we made a demo tape, and it was really fun. I had a hard time with the group sort of dynamics of it, and you know, so many different expectations, and you know, and then you write a song and tell people are telling you like how that should end and stuff like that. It's like, no.
Well, you found the answer. I mean, a lot of artists, I feel like, do that, where, you know, the band life, the collaborative part is tricky.
Yes.
Even just the getting them to show up at the same time. It's like, really, we're going to wait like an hour here while people in the band show up. Whereas if you're in your own studio, you work when you work. You're your boss, you know?
I mean, if I was into music today and I could just like have my computer and my synthesizer and my guitar and just like, you know, make a whole album myself, that would be amazing.
You might never leave.
I know. I mean,
it's amazing, isn't it, though? Like that demo tape you recorded, you probably had to go somewhere.
Oh yeah, we like found a studio. We found a guy who had a studio in Cleveland, and like it was awesome because I was in one room with the bass player, and the drummer was up in the garage, and the keyboard player was like in the side room, whatever. It was awesome.
You feel like you're doing something.
Yeah,
like, and now it's like bedroom production. You just know, you do everything.
Yeah, well, and he recorded on DAT. Remember DAT?
Digital audio tape. Yeah, that was a short-lived sort of thing.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
It didn't have that much longevity.
Yeah.
The band I was in recorded at Electrical, Steve Albini's studio in Chicago, and we recorded on tape, which was awesome. Like it was hard, but there was like that analog tape. You know, there's something so different to that. Not to be, you know, that guy, but it was different. Like it had a different sound to it, which was really cool.
Absolutely. The whole analog digital thing is endlessly fascinating to me.
I agree. We lived through it, you know?
Yeah.
Like young people, that's not analog's more of like, oh yeah, that's a cool thing that you can, that's a little different. But when you migrate through it, you have a different relationship to like 4-track mixers and, you know, or like, you know, old tube amps. I got a Fender tube amp, and that thing was, you know, they're heavy and they're kind of a pain in the ass when the amps blow or the fuse blows or whatever. But I mean, they are like, they sound so warm.
Yeah. Yeah. They're amazing. Yeah. I have a Fender. I have my old Fender amp that I just brought to my house from my mother's house. And my 16-year-old daughter is playing. I got her a little pickup for her acoustic, and she's been playing with it.
Is it a twin or is it smaller? Is it like a?
It's actually not even a real tube amp. It's like sort of a fake tube amp, but it's
They sound good though.
It sounds good, yeah.
Yeah, my son has a Vox, one of those. It's not a tube amp, but it sounds pretty good.
Yeah,
it sounded better than anything I played into in high school. I think I was using like a stereo speaker that I somehow rigged to be like put a 1/4-inch jack into it and like play guitar through it.
Yeah. Not
the best.
Yeah.
But you make do, you know.
Yeah.
Were you, not to jump too far forward, but in your own equipment, are you analog digital curious? I think I just
my photography equipment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I've been shooting film forever. 4x5. But I just went on a trip and to make some work, and I bought a digital camera.
How could you?
I know. I mean, I feel the same way, but I felt a lot of pressure to really like get as much as I could out of the trip. And usually I show up on a shoot with 10 to 15 sheets of 4x5 film. And that's like it's a real gamble. And so I was like, I'm going to bring a digital. And it was,
well, they're amazing.
It's pretty amazing, I gotta say. Yeah. And it's not all good, but on balance it kinda is. And I'm struggling with that, you know, because I have this connection to analog, and as I said, I'm all about process, and I really like the process of using film. You know.
Yeah, it's tough, isn't it? I grew up with vinyl. I had records. I had a record player. And I listened to vinyl all the time. And at a certain point, I moved to New York and I was like, bye-bye vinyl. You know what I mean? And then I had CDs, which became obscene. I had a ginormous collection.
Yeah.
And then streaming. I feel the same, probably the same conflict you feel, although yours is more indebted to your process. But, you know, that feeling of like, well, yeah, I can just stream everything and it's all there, you know. Nigerian High Life from, you know, 1958 or something. I got it, you know, with the click of a... But then it's not the same because you don't have that same relationship. It's hard, you know.
Yeah, yeah, truly.
It's kind of like we're kind of blessed to have that predicament in a way, you know. I mean, digital cameras are pretty amazing. And you can do things that you just never would be able to do with giant Polaroid. But they give you something, you know, I guess... best of both worlds in a way. You use some of that when you need it and use some of that when you need it.
Yeah, I actually bought a ton of film for that trip that I took and I didn't use one sheet of it. So I have a lot of film and I need to use it. So I'm not giving up entirely on that.
Right. Yeah. Well, when did the camera enter your life? Were you taking pictures as a kid?
I took a photography class in middle school and loved it. Yeah. And weirdly enough, the other day, my middle school art teacher liked one of my images on Instagram. And I was like,
you recognize
the
name? You were like, oh.
And I wrote to her, I DM'd her, and I was like, hi. Would you happen to be my middle school art teacher? And like 2 days later, she replied, yes.
Sounds like the correct pace for
an old
teacher from the past. Yeah.
But it was not an effusive reply. And I wrote her back and I was like, you're a great teacher. Thank you. Also, I'm sorry that I ruined your whale watching film in whatever year that was. when I was
What'd you do?
15 years old. Basically, she had deemed me to be a competent in the darkroom. And she was like, you know, Thomas is doing really well loading film. And we all came back to class on a Monday and she's like, I went whale watching on a whale watching cruise, you know, in Massachusetts or whatever over the weekend. Would you like to load my film for me? And I was like, absolutely. I totally screwed it up. Because you know how it happens, you don't get it on the spool right, and it's like touching, and and it makes these horrible blotches on the film.
Oh no!
I felt terrible. She was totally cool about it.
Oh, that's
nice. At the time, but you know, she like you know she elevated me and gave me this opportunity. Oh God, you know.
When you wrote that long you know thing to her, did she reply okay? Period.
She said, "I didn't remember that." Which was a huge relief to me. So basically, I'm off the hook because she doesn't even remember. So it's
you're
all
like, pretend I didn't even write the stuff about the whales. Yeah. You never went whale watching.
No.
I was an ace in that studio.
Well, you know, I would love if she still had that film because to me, like the ruined whale watching film is much more interesting than the whale watching film, is it not?
Oh, it probably would be amazing to see.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So I maybe she'll dig it up, but I don't think she's gonna.
But so you were working with film back then, film.
Yeah, yeah, and I really liked it, but it never occurred to me that it was a thing that I wanted to do. And in fact, I took another photography class in college, and totally loved it. Again, it didn't occur to me that this was something.
But you went for something else, right? You didn't go for art.
Yeah, I wanted to be a writer.
That's different.
Yeah.
It's a different pace.
It is. And, you know, I think, I mean, I don't regret that. I mean, I don't really regret anything. But right. I think if I'd been more in touch with who I am and how I work and what's like a clear path for me and what's a path full of obstructions, I think I should have seen earlier that making art and doing photography was a great thing for me to do. Would have been a great thing for me to do. But I just came to it very, very slowly.
You never know, though. I mean, that maybe those bumps in the road were, you know, were important.
Absolutely. I mean,
it seems like
Absolutely.
It worked out for you.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that to second guess yourself and to think about how you could have done things differently is, it's kind of interesting, but it's I think even our failures and all the things that don't go the way we want them to are part of the story. And
right.
It would be a completely different story without them.
Yeah, you could have went to art school and then joined a performance art collective and started dancing naked in the woods and
yeah.
never was heard from again.
Absolutely.
Actually, that doesn't sound that bad.
It sounds good, actually. I mean, I think a lot about what would have happened if I went to art school.
Right? Yeah.
It's such a,
you'll never know. Like, I only went to universities, and I talked to so many people who went to art school. And I always wonder, like, how would I have done in, like, an art school? You know? Never know.
But you went to an art school in a university, though.
Yeah, but, you know, it would have been different. You know, Penn State is a lot different than, like, SVA. You know what I mean? So I just wonder, you know, it would be different. You think that stuff all the time, I think. Or, not living in regret or whatever, but just wonder, like, oh, what would have happened if I, you know, made that left turn at Albuquerque, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the only thing that's for sure is that I'd have a bunch of friends that I would have made in art school. But everything else is impossible to know.
You're not hanging out with tons of writers these days? The old connects?
Yeah, I've got my publishing buddies still.
Yeah? Are you still... Do you... Well, not still, but do you write?
No, not really.
It's hard, isn't it?
it's really hard. It was something... I loved having done it.
Yeah,
It's sort of like what Mark Twain says about reading a classic. It's everyone wants to have read classics, but they don't want to actually read them. And I had this incredible euphoria when I'd had written something and when completed it and was happy with it, but the process was excruciating.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, I wrote, you know, the book that I did for the podcast was like, it, you know, like having it in my hand was amazing and being able to reflect was great. The process, but when I'm in my studio painting, I love the process. I mean, it's difficult, but I live for that. And then when I'm done, I send it to the gallery, I send it somewhere, and then I forget about it. It's on to the next process. So it's like flipped.
Yeah.
Writing, it's like, I just want the end product. You know, the process is like a real slog. But then again, it's probably because I'm not good at it. And some people, I'm sure, it flows like water.
I mean, I've known people for whom it does flow like water. And other people for whom it's just as difficult as what we're describing. But I think it didn't fit what I'm capable of and what I'm good at. You know, I mean, I think I was really interested in being like a long form, like personal journalism writer. Like I was obsessed with Joseph Mitchell and John McPhee and Ian Frazier, basically all these New Yorker guys, and Susan Orlean, people like that. And I feel like I was really good at coming up with great ideas for these stories that I wanted to write. But when it came down to the actual execution, it was just like hitting a wall. And I think that kind of writing requires just like a lot of organization and a lot of long-term planning that honestly I'm just not capable of. It I'm really not.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
I work in real time.
I mean, it's such a process, right?
I mean, I have this joke but I have this joke with my wife that she like wants me to, you know, plan a trip for us, and I'm like, I'm just It's not my strength. But when we're on a trip and things go wrong, I'm really good at real-time problem solving on the ground. But when it comes to like putting all the pieces together in an abstract future place, I have a hard time with that.
It's not so much the preemptive, it's more the react. Like, you're good in the spot.
Yeah.
But like doing that stuff beforehand is true. Which is funny because I imagine, in your, I only know your work as your work from probably fairly recent, but it seems so kind of like, it seems like there's a lot of planning.
there is a lot of, I mean, I wouldn't call it planning. I'd call it trial and error.
That's true. That's true.
I mean, every piece is, I guess you could think every piece is a plan for the next piece in a sense. Right. But I sort of incrementally improve how I work with each piece, but yet each piece is its own improvisation. And I have many times in the past tried to plan things out and to sort of, you know, very carefully pick a location and then plan, you know, with drawings and whatever, you know, exactly what I want to do. And on the occasions when I have tried to do that, as soon as I'm on the ground actually working, I just throw it all out the window. Yeah. And just go. Right. Partly because there's always some variable that I didn't anticipate.
Right.
That I have to adapt to, and I tend to sort of like completely change and go in a new direction.
Does it feel better though, if you do go, like, you can imagine like a director or someone who's, you know, producing a movie, you know, things are going to change, like the location, there's just going to be so much, like you're talking about, nothing is going to go to plan, but they have to sketch something. You know, there is the logistics and all that stuff. I imagine you feel, or is it just kind of like reactionary, like impulsive whenever you're in that, when it's actually time to create the piece, you're just going with it, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think I have some vague, fuzzy idea of what I want things to look like. And so I can, you know, I work with that, but I don't, you know, being really specific is sort of like trying to have control. And
right.
I think I've realized over the years that trying to be in control is not the best thing for me. And in fact, relinquishing control is a better path for me, and
right.
will yield better results.
Right. Well, with writing, was it like that, where it was kind of like more concrete, and then you got the feeling of like, well, it's too anchored, or, you know, because a lot of times I always do this in critiques with students, where I'll say, you know, well, it's okay because you're an artist, you're making images. If you really wanted to spell it out, you would write, because then you could define it. And I realize there's poetry, there's kinds of writings that are abstract or whatever, but were you tending towards the more literal or representational in your writing? And then you found that when you can make visual work, because your visual work feels so ephemeral and not pegged down, you know?
I mean, I was more interested in journalism than fiction. And I think the connection is that to write fiction, I feel like you're just kind of starting from a blank canvas. And, you know, I think there can be a lot of reportorial fiction where you're bringing things in from real life, but still it feels like a blank piece of paper, and, you know, I'm going to make it all up. And that kind of, the prospect of that terrifies me. Much the same way being a painter, the prospect of that would be utterly terrifying to me. Because I just feel like I can't do it all myself. Whereas the thing I like about sort of the kind of personal journalism that I was so interested in was that it was finding these fascinating details about places or people, and then just reorganizing them.
I guess that is a link.
And finding extraordinary things in ordinary people and places.
Oh, right. Yeah.
And so I think for me, I like to take these very day-to-day, you know, quotidian objects and materials and try to transform them into something surprising.
Right.
Or weird, that makes or sense. Whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, there's a strange, like a sort of alien you know, because they're kind of injected with life that you don't understand, like, what's, you know, where it's coming from, really.
It's yeah.
Kind of cool.
Yeah. And I think if you came on a shoot with me, you'd be surprised, as I always am, at how when I first begin making the thing, it just kind of looks like what it is.
Yeah.
But then as it gets bigger and I'm finished doing what I'm doing, and then the elements start to interact with it, the wind and the softening light, it just it undergoes a transformative sort of moment, and that's what I go for.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I've always wanted to go to Nepal, so maybe I can book that trip. If you could just tag me along.
Okay.
With that one.
Okay.
Does that sound good?
Sounds good. Sounds good. That sounds a little chilly, but okay.
Yeah, well, you know, it's for the art.
The light's good.
Right, right. How did you get to that point? So you go to school for writing. I mean, it's, you know, it's a jump. How did you go from A to B, basically?
I mean, I didn't even go to school for writing. I have no advanced degrees. I have a bachelor's in history.
Oh, okay.
And so,
but I mean, you went to school for something outside of art, technically. So,
yeah.
How did you make that transition?
Well, I was working at a magazine in New York.
I imagine that was chaotic.
You know, not really, actually, because it was.
It was okay.
When I started, it was a quarterly magazine.
Oh.
And
okay.
Then by the time I left, it was bi-monthly, so it was pretty glacial pace.
Right.
I mean, it was not, we were not out in the middle of the river there. We were sort of in a little eddy on the banks. And it was, I mean, it was a really fun job. I mean, I traveled a lot and wrote travel stories. I edited like a section of book reviews. In the last few years I was there, I wrote an electronics column, which was kind of fun. So I sort of got to go to the tech shows and
the conventions to see all the new stuff.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
Cool.
Which ultimately was disappointing, because you just realized that 95% of it was just landfill. The actual innovation was kind of hard to find. But I mean, that was really fun. But I think I gradually came to that conclusion over those years that I wasn't going to be able to accomplish, as a writer, what I wanted to accomplish. Like what I was saying before, I just loved coming up with great ideas, but the actual process of executing them was overwhelming to me. It's sort of like, I think I kind of went through the same thing as a musician. You know, I think I loved what I was doing, but I kind of decided that I wasn't going to be able to go where I wanted to go.
Right.
Just in terms of my own skills and desire. And so gradually, while I had that job, I sort of became interested in taking pictures again. And I'm not sure exactly why, honestly. I mean, I have a friend from college who was doing the photography, was director of photography at Details magazine, and I would hang out with her a lot, and she would talk about photography a lot, and she was like finding all these young photographers and introducing them in Details magazine, sort of launching a lot of careers. And I don't know, I met a bunch of people through her who were cool photographers and just sort of became interested. And I got a camera. I got a 35mm camera and started walking around taking pictures.
So first, it was kind of related to work, but it wasn't, it's not like you turned and said like, oh, now I'm going to take, you know, art photos.
I mean, it wasn't related to work. I mean, I did manage to do a few photo shoots for articles in the magazine.
Yeah.
That I wrote. Like I went to Toronto. I can't believe they let me do this, but I went to Toronto to a rock, paper, scissors competition. Like
that's
literally a bunch
amazing.
Of dudes playing rock, paper, scissors.
Yeah.
I took pictures. And I wrote the story. Oh, no, actually, my buddy wrote the story. So we went together. He wrote the story, and I took the pictures. So that was sort of like me sort of making a little transition. And, you know, like I was saying, when I went to the electronic show in Vegas, I would book my ticket, And then not book my return for like 4 days after the convention was over, and take some time off and drive around the desert with my like Crown Graphic 4x5, and do like landscape pictures in the desert, which I really enjoyed. And that was like, cause like in New York, first I started, I was like kind of doing street photography, you know, seeing what I could do with that. But I was never really comfortable with, like, being bold with the camera and like either asking people's permissions or sticking a camera in their face. You know, right. I couldn't really do that. Then I got a 4x5 and started like trying to be like Richard Mizrock or something out in the desert, which was really fun. And I started taking some classes at ICP. Like I took a color printing class and another critique class and also a digital printing class as well. And I would lurk around the East River in the lower Manhattan, like taking abstract pictures of like waves crashing on the piers and stuff. And I actually found a bunch of them recently in a box in the basement.
Did you like them?
I like them. They're the opposite of what I'm doing now, because I was shooting something moving with a really fast shutter speed. Because at the beginning of my interest in photography, I was really focused on sharpness. And now, as you can tell, I completely changed in my taste.
Right, right.
But I thought those pictures were kind of cool. And so it gradually grew and grew and became a bigger and bigger part of my life. And then I got fired from my magazine job.
I've actually been,
admitted this to myself recently, but I've more or less been fired a lot. Like I'm kind of unemployable, I think. And now that I've like sort of reached a level in my art career, I feel like I can just say that.
You're the boss of you now.
So. Yeah, yeah. But you know, my first job in New York, I worked at the Strand. Fired.
Oh, nice. Oh, really? Were you late?
No, I think at the time I told myself it was a conspiracy, a grand conspiracy, because I think I talked too much about how I didn't want to work there. And I was like, I was like, I'm just stopping off here. I'm going to get a job in publishing. And there was this guy named Kurt who did the tables in the middle of the store. And he, it was an honor. He actually asked me to help him. And I helped him, and I'm not sure if he liked the job I did, but then they also gave me a shot at working at the cash registers, and they thought I didn't do a good enough job with the cash registers, but they probably were justified. But it's also a kind of thing where you get to 3 months working there, and I think it's 3 months. It's either 3 months or 6 months, and then you would automatically join the union and get health insurance.
So they
tend to fire the people right before that point, and I think they fired me. But like the woman who fired me, I like totally like saw her like drinking beer at lunchtime, you know, every day, and I'm like, I can't believe like this is a low bar that I'm not able to reach.
Maybe it's a status to get fired from
school. I know it's a badge of honor. Then I worked at Simon & Schuster after that for a while. So I got into publishing, but I didn't work in editorial. I actually ended up in the publicity department, which was pretty intense.
PR.
I would get assigned these authors, and they weren't like the big authors. They were sort of the mid-list authors. And they would expect me to like take care of them and make their book a big success. And they would get like a month or two of my attention. And then I would like have to break up with them. But they would think that I was just their vassal for life. But I would just be like, I can't really work with you anymore. I have to move on to other things. But it was, I don't know, it was not great. But then I didn't get fired from there. I just kind of got, they kind of gave me a little nudge. But then I got this Forbes.
Encouraged to quit.
Yeah, yeah. I think maybe they just sensed that I wasn't, 1,000% committed or something
right.
like that.
Yeah.
So when I left the magazine job, I more or less decided to do this.
Yeah.
And it was a lot of years of kind of scraping along, and my wife was so understanding and supportive most That's of the cool. time.
Yeah. I was just going to say, how did you find the materials, like that process that you have, which is so, it's unique and specific. I mean, where did you come up with that?
The first thing is I sort of started becoming more and more interested in sort of staged photography.
Mm-hmm.
Like when I discovered Gregory Crutzen, who I saw was one of your guests, right?
Yeah.
I was really totally blown away by that, by his stuff.
Impressive.
And I wouldn't have to deal with the anxiety of, doing street photography if I could just create everything on my own.
Right.
And at a certain point, my wife and I bought a little shack up in the Catskills with a few acres attached to it. And I just started building stuff and experimenting there. And so I'd make these like weird sculptures out of sticks and fluorescent lights, and I'd go to Pennsylvania and buy fireworks. And so I'd use smoke bombs and Roman candles. And I just sort of started going nuts up there with my Shenhao 4x5 and whatever else I could dredge up. I did this long project that was these pictures of this robot, which was just totally out of left field. I actually started doing this like before that Wall-E thing came out, but it was kind of a similar thing. It was like sort of this, it was a narrative, which I would never do now, but it seemed like a good idea at the time. It was sort of a narrative series of this robot living in the woods in upstate New York. And then for the first series of pictures were him sort of doing thankless grunt work, which I think it was a reflection of my sort of complicated relationship with work and having a job, because right. I did have a job at the time. But then I started making these strange sort of sculptures out of sticks and what I was talking about, fireworks and smoke bombs that this robot would encounter. And so he started having these sort of slightly menacing encounters with these things, around this house and in the woods and stuff. And then eventually he started succumbing to them and they killed him and all sorts of stuff. And I did a book. I did a handmade book that I can send you a Vimeo link to, out of like wood that I salvaged from the woods, from a fallen down chicken coop that was in the woods by this house we had. And like nuts and bolts, and I wanted it to be rusty, so I like used Coca-Cola to make all the screws and stuff tarnish and everything. It was really fun. I planned on making like 12 of them, but I flamed out at 5, I think. And they weigh about like 10 pounds. And they have a little light that turns on, and it's totally That's quirky. Cool. It's the kind of thing where if I'd gone to art school, they never would have let me do this. which might have been a good thing, I don't know. It was a super fun project, and it sort of led to what I'm doing now, because I just the sort of the sculptural apparitions that I had this character confronting were what evolved into the work that I'm doing now.
Right.
So I started doing things like that exclusively in upstate New York, and then we ended up letting go of that house, and then shortly after that we went to California. And California was really hard at the beginning for me to continue doing the work that I was doing, because I'd developed this whole process where I was tying stuff to trees.
Right.
And as you know, unless you're in a redwood forest, there's not that many trees in California. Yeah. I didn't see what's amazing about the California landscape for a while. I was just like, I have nowhere to tie shit to. So I had to sort of develop my own system to create my own off-camera structures to suspend all my little monofilaments from. And so that was a whole new process where I sort of had to reinvent what I was doing.
Do you think that was good? Because a lot of your work looks as though you're adapting to different environments.
I mean, it was fueling. Yeah, it was wonderful in retrospect. I mean, it was really challenging at the time. And I think the first year that I was there was extremely unproductive. But then with each passing year, I sort of got more confident and was able to develop more ideas about how to do my work, that it just got better and better. And I came to realize that the fact that there are so few trees in California was great for me, because the quality of the light at dusk is just vastly superior in California, because you have that open horizon that's unobstructed by trees.
Different palette too, right?
Different palette, but also, you know, much more challenging in terms of wind, because in Northern California, it's just a constant presence. Very consistent, constant presence. And I fought it for years. Or I wouldn't say fought it, I tried to outmaneuver it. And I would try to, you know, look at the weather forecast and find days when the wind would not be blowing, so that I could string up some like plastic stuff and have it not either tangle up irreparably or just be a blur in my in my photograph. And I got lucky a lot, fortunately, but a lot of times I was just totally foiled, and I would like make something out of, you know, I mean, I remember in this really cool place called Cougar Buttes, like an hour outside of LA, it's like BLM land. I spent hours making this thing out of like file folders, like paper file folders, and the wind kicked up, and in like 2 minutes, it just turned the whole thing into a tangled disaster.
Yeah.
And that happened kind of a lot. But gradually, I sort of came to the realization that I needed to conform instead of fight.
I needed to befriend the wind.
I needed to create things that were specifically designed for the wind. And that was very liberating for me.
Yeah, and the video component of it is very compelling to see that. I don't know if that's like a happy accident or a byproduct of, you know, being able to share stuff on social media or whatever, but seeing that movement is such a nice byproduct of that dance with the wind.
Yeah, I mean, I was doing videos 10 years ago, and my wife was always like, that is awesome. Like, that's...
Yeah.
She didn't say that's cooler than the picture, but she was like, that's amazing. But it always takes me a few years to figure out something on my own that somebody else told me already. And I think I've now really embraced that the video is like a really important part of what I'm doing.
We're all like that, aren't we? Stubborn, because we have our direction and other people aren't seeing it through the lens of making it. So they just respond to things in a more direct way sometimes. We always had a rule of thumb in the studio. It's like if a teacher comes in and says something and you just totally disagree, it goes against everything you think. Then you know what? Screw it. Just throw it out. But then if like five people come in and say the same thing, you got to listen, because something's going on there. Yeah. You know, like you're missing the bus if that's the case. So.
Yeah. It was also a logistical issue for me, because my shoots tend to be so demanding, and I'm so sort of harried in my pursuit to finish before the sun goes down, that to add another task into that, like shooting video, is stressful to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that just gives me more incentive to sort of be a little bit more organized.
Right.
To be plan. You know, I know that back to the planning thing though, which is not my greatest strength.
Right, right. That's we battle. I mean, you know, a lot of times people look at my work and say like, oh, it's so neat, or it's like orderly. And your studio must be so neat, or you must be, and it's not the case at all. It's like, you know, sometimes your work embraces battles in your life that you feel like you need to face, and you almost face it more in your work than you do in your regular life.
Yeah.
I don't know why that is.
Absolutely.
There's got to be some sort of negotiation that's going on unconsciously between us and the world, you know?
Well, I was thinking a lot about all the shoots that I've done that were failures. And I kind of feel like I should go look at them and dredge them up and maybe not see them as secondary or pieces that should not be seen. Because I think I kind of had this, you know, I was sick recently, possibly with COVID, but I'm not sure. Because I didn't have any tests where I was. But there was one morning when I just like had these fever dreams that was like,
oh, wow.
I was like, it was like an acid trip practically. I was like, my mind was just going crazy and I had to like take notes and everything. But in one of my realizations in my fever dream was that I think my pieces are kind of self-portraits in a sense. And if that's the case, then the failures are every bit as valid and worth looking at than the ones that I like and that I'm proud of.
That's a good point. It's really hard though, right? It's like acknowledging things that, you know, like when you look in the mirror and you're like, well, that's not, you just want to not pay attention to certain things, or, you know what I mean? It's hard to look like completely
at your
process or yourself. And, you know, we're almost better at tricking ourselves than anyone else is.
Yeah, yeah. But it also just kind of makes it more interesting when you can see the good and the bad,
right?
And the whole narrative.
Yeah, that's true. Well, it's funny because cameras inherently, they don't do that. I mean, they're hiding things. You know what I mean? Not that it's staged, but it is a representation of an actual thing, but it's, which all art is, it's artifice, it's like a fate, it means it's a simulacra. But, you know, with photography, it's specifically leaning towards realism in the sense that it's a photograph, but it's not always what you think it is.
Well, and particularly in my case, it's the fact that most of my work now is shot with these long exposures.
Right.
It's a demonstrably inaccurate portrayal of what's actually happening there. The videos are you know, pretty accurate, but like the fact that I can shoot things at a, you know, quarter of a second, and they sort of lose their edges, makes them transform into something that you don't see with your naked eye.
But it really is like painting in a way, in the sense that, you know, like if you look at Pollock dancing around the canvas and that, all those brush strokes are a collective presentation of his movements that he did over the course of making it. You know, it's one frozen moment of all this collective action. And in a way, that one frozen moment is a collective action of like whatever it is, a quarter of a second. But it's all that movement and shape and form and dynamics. So in a way, it's very real. It's realism.
Yeah, yeah.
It's abstract at the same time. In a way.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a collection of moments instead of a single moment, which I love. I mean, I think that makes it stickier, and more worth staring at. But I am like interested. I'm introspective about how I went from wanting my images to be sharp to being blurry, and I kind of wonder why that is. Maybe it's just like getting older. It's partly reading Walter Isaacson's Leonardo biography that was, I mean, I was already, I had already, you know, gone blurry at that point when I read that, but it sort of crystallized a lot of my thinking for me, because, you know, the thing about all that stuff about sfumato and how the Mona Lisa, one of the reasons it's so amazing is that there are no edges.
Right. Yeah.
And I feel like that blurriness just gives my work so much more, the fact that you can't stop anywhere, you know, it's more movement, more intrigue. I don't know.
Yeah, I get it. It creates, it's like when things are outlined or too defined, you understand it quickly and you move on. Even if you don't really understand it, you think, oh, I get it. But then anytime there is that sort of ethereal ambiguity, your mind will want to deliberate. You know, you stay in the image and the idea longer because it's not defined. It's not that one word response from your middle school art teacher. It's kind of like, you know, a little, it's more open. You can reflect more on it.
Yeah. The key thing, though, is that something has to be in focus. There need some details that you can see, you know, juxtaposed with ones you can't. If it's all just one big blur,
it's an Uta Barth photo.
Yeah,
which is great, but yeah, it's a whole different thing. It becomes about, you know, no focus. Really.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the dynamics. It's the dynamics of the idea of a photograph representing one moment in time, but there's moments in there compressed. You know, it's the idea of, that things are out of focus, but then everything else is kind of in focus. So it's the dynamic between the two that really, you know, keeps you engaged in the image.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that's where a lot of work goes to die, is where it's just like, okay, I get it, you know. And it's the analogy of like punk rock. I mean, I love punk rock, but punk rock just like says it to you, you know. There's no kind of like ambiguity. It's just like, here it is, you know what I mean? Which was needed, and sometimes that's needed, but there's something to be said for asking the viewer some questions or leaving some ambiguity there for them to bring whatever they have to the image, you know.
Yeah, and I love the idea that everyone brings something else, and everyone sees something different. The flip side of that is that oftentimes people see things that I don't see. I don't really want them to see. I mean, I think
that's the rub.
I mean, I think a lot of times people just see the aesthetics, and they're like, I think that's beautiful, or that makes me feel calm, and I'm like, well, that's nice. But that's, I mean, obviously, I want them to see a lot more than that. But you can't always. But I think aesthetics are a great place to start. But I think,
right.
I think the more you keep developing whatever idea it is, the more starts to happen
behind the scenes. Yeah, and if you can get one or two out of 10 people to really buy in, that's a pretty good ratio.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Just like if you invite everyone to a party to bring something, if only one person brings rotten deviled eggs, it's a pretty good ratio. You're getting overall, it's worth it. You're doing well.
Yeah.
So these days, when you're shooting your work, is it basically like, okay, not to get into planning again, but I mean, you're doing some. It seems like you move around, like you're not just shooting in one place. So, is quote unquote like going to the studio and making the work, there's space in between and there's like this movement and there's different places, and you know, it's a different kind of thing to go into a white cube, right? Just making work every day.
Yeah, I mean, it really depends on where I can go and what's going to be happening wherever that is. Yeah. I mean, the great thing about California is that there's so many wide open spaces. And there's lots of places to go all year round. And you can find a beach that won't be crowded or have any people on it at all in on July 4th weekend. Whereas the East Coast, the coast just fills up, as you know, in the summertime. And so, for instance, like in the spring of this year, I did a lot of shooting at on Assateague Island off the coast of Maryland, which is, I'd never been there before until we moved to Philadelphia, but God, what a beautiful place. Like a beautiful stretch of totally undeveloped Atlantic coastline.
Wow. And you drive to it, or do you?
Yeah, it's a good, like 2.5 hour drive. Oh, it's such a, just, it's a little bridge. It's not like a, you know, Martha's Vineyard or something.
Right.
But I would go there in the off season, and I found a place where I could park, where I could kind of sneak in away from any other big parking lot. So if anybody was going to get to where I was, they were going for a long walk.
Yeah.
And I had some great shoots there. Sometimes someone will invite me to go somewhere, which is great. But for the most part, it's me trying to figure out where I can shoot and whether or not I'm going to need to ask permission. And if I don't ask permission, what the chances are of me getting in trouble, which I never actually haven't actually gotten in trouble, but I have a lot of anxiety about getting in trouble. I don't know why.
Yeah.
It's just imposter syndrome or something like that.
Well, it's from being fired from Strand. It's their fault.
It's all the firings. but yeah, so, you know, I sometimes I have a hard time getting myself motivated.
Yeah.
And I go through, you know, periods of inactivity. It's sort of like exercising, you know. Going for a run is the first time is really hard, but once you do it a couple times, you get into a routine. But I have to travel now in a way I didn't in California.
Right.
And the pandemic year in California was quite productive for me because, you know, we're in Marin County, which is just an incredibly beautiful place. And my wife was suddenly working from home, and the kids were just on Zoom at home. And so I was kind of free.
And going out, there's not a lot of people out.
And so, I could go to
and
all...
And people are staying away. So exactly. You had like, it was exactly. Almost a perfect storm in a way.
Exactly. And, you know, a lot of times you weren't supposed to even park by the side of the road, you know, in the peak COVID lockdowns.
Yeah.
But for the most part, I could go out and do whatever I wanted.
Right.
And I really like... developed some ideas and was able to sort of really hammer at some stuff that year, which was great. But it's hard for me to replicate that being on the East Coast. But I did actually just go to Nantucket for like a week, and actually a little more than a week. And I really like pushed myself in a way that I haven't before. Because usually my shoots are like physically and emotionally exhausting to me, and I'll do like two in 2 days, and I'm like, I need a break.
That's it. Yeah.
Because like physically, I carry a ton of gear to wherever I'm shooting, and that might be 100 meters, and it might be a half a mile, depending on where I'm going. And then it's just like a lot hours of repetitive work, and then I shoot at dusk, and then I have to break the whole thing down more or less in the dark. And then haul it back to my car, and it's just it's fun, but it's also sort of an ordeal. But on Nantucket, I just kind of turned it off, and went into just work mode, and just kept going. And I
that's cool.
I ended up doing like 10 shoots in a little less than 2 weeks, which is like
that must have felt good.
I mean, that's like a year's work for me in other years. It was great, and it was a revelation that I can actually do a lot more than I thought I could do.
Right. I mean, do you ever think about moving on somewhere like Greenland?
I mean, that'd be great. That'd be great. How are the schools there, though? You know.
Yeah, I don't know. You might have to do some of that homeschooling we've heard about.
Yeah.
Imagine that. No thanks.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think about moving someplace where it would be easy for me to work, but. Those places tend to also be extremely expensive. So that's a problem because everyone else wants to be there too.
Yeah, or it's so remote that it's not even doable. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I'm sure Antarctica would be amazing.
Yeah.
Chilly, but, you know, some good photogenic.
Yeah, I'm trying to plan a trip to Canada in the spring, but we'll see.
Yeah, I'm sure there's some amazing. Cool, I mean, that it sounds. I mean, logistically, I know it's difficult and having a family and all that stuff. But the idea to travel to make work, I mean, it's really it's great. It's a great excuse to sort of see amazing places. You know,
yeah,
it's pretty cool.
Yeah, yeah, and it's sort of my work is sort of my way of being in nature. I've kind of decided. Yeah. I mean, I love hiking, you know, with my family or friends or whatever. But I wouldn't say that that's something that I'll really do alone that much unless I was location scouting.
Right.
Fishing never really took for me. You know, obviously I don't hunt or anything like that. But I find that making my work in these beautiful locations is sort of my way of connecting with nature. And it involves basically being in the same place for many hours. And you see a lot when you stay in the same place for a long time. You know, at the beach, you know, on Nantucket, I mean, seals would come visit me. They wouldn't come out of the water, but they would like come stick their heads out and check me out for a while.
Whale watching?
Didn't see any whales, but in California, one time I was doing a shoot on a beach in south of San Francisco, and like a pod of whales, not like humpbacks or anything, but like I think maybe pilot whales, were right off the brink, like right offshore, and they were so close to the shore that I thought, like, are they going to beach themselves or something? And of course, the thought went through my mind, if those whales beach themselves, do I have to stop my shoot and try to help them? Or what am I going to do? Or what's going to happen? Yeah. You know, I've seen like flying squirrels and, you know, all sorts of cool stuff. And I love just being in a place and watching how it transforms over the hours that I'm there. I mean, I get there at 11 in the morning and it's bright and contrasty. And when I leave, it's pitch dark. But that time from like, you know, 6 to 8 or whatever, when hopefully I've finished doing what I'm doing, and I've experienced the transformation of nature itself, but also what it's done to the thing that I've made, is really a powerful experience for me.
Yeah, yeah, I can imagine. I mean, I just go sit in a room.
Yeah.
Put on some music and just paint on a wall. So that sounds really nice. I mean, I'm sure the grass is always greener, right? There's something great about just going to the same place, and there's something amazing about being on the road. So, I think we learn how to let our fire be fueled by whatever the conditions are.
Yeah. And we find the thing that feels like open road to us.
Right.
And easy is not the right word, but something where you love being in it and being in the process. And I'm the kind of person who is restless and doesn't like doing nothing, but is also really lazy. And that's a toxic combination. and so that means that if left to my own devices, I'll think of all the things that I should be doing, but not be able to do them, and then probably just like read the New York Times and get stressed out about you know, the midterms. Whereas when I'm out there doing a shoot, like I feel free. I feel like the repetitive work of it is feels good to me. Like it feels good for me mentally. It's just it's something that it comes naturally, and I feel incredibly blessed to have found that thing.
It's amazing, and I think it's great because I feel like that kind of vibe comes across in the work, you know. So it's really cool that it reverberates in that sense. You know, you feel this sort of flow state kind of connection to outdoors or nature, but in a way that feels like, I don't want to say alien, but, you know, it just feels like otherworldly in a sense. You know, it's almost like an escape, like a visual escape. So
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah, well, another thing I've been thinking about a lot lately is the materials I use.
Yeah.
Because as you know, I mean, I started out doing this work with, you know, pure petrochemical byproducts, you know, the plastic cups and and the plastic plates and you know, the trashy food products like cheese balls. And that's like been a big part of my work, like sort of presenting this contrast between the things that we make and the natural world. And and sort of a goal with every shoot is to sort of create a piece that feels like it's in conflict with its environment, but also in harmony with it at the same time. That said, I get like a fair amount of flack, particularly on social media, about using that mesh tool material. Because, you know, it's nylon, you know, it's oil essentially. And on one hand, it's, as I said, it's sort of like part of the point of my work. On the other hand, I take it to heart, and I would really like to be working more with organic, sustainable materials. So I have been doing that. I've now done three pieces with silk, which is a heck of a lot more expensive than nylon tulle, I tell you. And I've done a number of pieces with linen and cotton, which has been really fun, and I'm really excited about some of the results. But it's more challenging, and those materials aren't as mind-blowingly versatile as nylon tulle. And so I kind of feel like in a microcosm, I'm going through sort of the same struggles that we are as a society as a whole, in that we want to not use these petrochemical products, but they're so damned useful and hard to replace. And it's easy to dunk on plastic straws and paper bags, but there's all kinds of other stuff that we don't want to talk about, but that's like so vital to our lives, like in the clothes we wear and at the supermarket, everything's wrapped in plastic. Even at the health food store, and there'll be tons of plastic. And the reason is because there's no like viable, cheap alternative. And so like, it's fun for me to think about this kind of thing in the context of my own work, and to sort of make it a personal goal to try to find things that I can work with that are not, you know, these sorts of products. Like, for instance, there's a company that's making fabric out of algae, and I've been like talking to them on Instagram trying to get them to send me some, and they're dragging their feet right now, but it's like, you know, as much as I think the criticisms that people make are missing the point a little bit, at the same time, it pushes me to explore in a new direction, which I like.
Yeah, we can always, I think everyone in their life can try to do what they can, you know what I mean, and make choices and use materials in a way that they feel. But to like publicly be criticizing people because they're using something that's man-made is just like, come on. I mean, you're making something beautiful out of something that's, you know, there are much bigger fish to be going after.
That's what I
think. Pollution and all that stuff. So, I mean, I grew up around straight edge kids who were like the most hardcore. Like, you know, I was vegetarian, they were vegan, and I was like the punk person, the crazy one. You know, I mean, it's just, you know, those people are using stuff in their day to day life. It's the same parallel of the things that you're using for the most part. I mean, it's, you know, that's just, social media is the worst. I mean, people just like, you know, soapboxing and complaining about stuff. It's like, just do what you can. Everyone can do what they want to do and do it how they want to do it. You know what I mean? And, you know, I would think, yeah, that stuff is like, it gets a little tight. I mean, I maybe I'm a little sensitive to it because that whole thing with throwing the soup on the Van Gogh that just happened.
Yeah.
I'm like, come on, there's a better way to do this. You know, like that's not the I mean, that's not the way to go about it.
There is a lot of environmental maximalism out there, And yeah. and I've sensed a change just in the past few years, whereas like, you know, 6 or 8 years ago, I felt like I could do what I wanted. But now people seem are like, you know, you're intruding on an environment. And did you think that you might have displaced a squirrel from its home for the hours that you were there? And in that case, it had a hard time getting the calories that it needs to survive, you know?
That's when it's time to turn the phone off or the computer off. Don't read anything. It's just there's always going to be someone who's, you know what I mean? We just have to do what we do. You know what I mean? I'm a problem because I make paintings. Yeah.
No, I mean, I think they're ridiculous, but it also is thought-provoking to me in a sense because it makes
me
think about where I stand on things. And, right. and it helps me sort of articulate my own form of environmentalism, which is, you know, definitely more pragmatic.
Yes.
Then
let them burn out their lithium batteries while, you know, tweeting you or rage commenting on your posts.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's all for the good, I guess.
Yeah.
So what, do you have anything coming up? Is there any way that people can, what's the best way for people to see what you're doing?
I mean, the dreaded Instagram is
I didn't ask the best way for people to publicly shaming you for
no. Well, that's where my materials. Work shows up the most.
right. No, I'm kidding.
And I did just produce a whole bunch of work that I'm going to be trickling out over the next few months.
Cool.
I don't have an exhibition on the near horizon. Although I am doing if we're in the late stages of approval for like a public art piece in Northern California, actually.
Nice.
In the town of Tiburon. So I'm gonna make a piece actually for live public consumption that will hopefully be there for a month or two. That's gonna be sort of a wind-driven piece, like on the
that's exciting
in a park on the water in Tiburon. Nice. And I'm trying to move more and more into that world, tentatively. I've gotten a fair number of invitations to do stuff, and I tend to say no because I don't feel comfortable with whatever the setting is or whoever. But I'm starting to pick ones that I think I can really succeed at, and sort of go slowly into that space because you know it is kind of a shame that I do these pieces in isolation, and every once in a while somebody will wander by. And see me, but for the most part, I'm the only witness to what I do.
Right. Yeah. No. That's exciting. That'd be a cool, you know, I don't want to say a new way, you know, but another way for the work to be experienced. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's harder for me because I often make things so that they look good from one angle. That's my main focus. Right. So to actually have to make something that needs to be good, look good from all directions, it's gonna take some more work.
I know it. I'm just only Zoom presentable. I only look good from here up. Like the bottom half, forget it.
Exactly.
We all do what we can. Well, maybe it's motivation.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, okay. So online, they can check out your work, and it was really great to talk to you. It's been like it's cool to hear your story and. You know, the work is like, it's really cool. There's nothing quite like it. So I'm really excited that you took the time out to talk to me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.